If you ask 10 conductors what their philosophy on score study is, you're likely to get 10 or 11 different answers. It really is a very personal sort of thing. There's one school of thought that says you should just not mark your scores, that marking your scores is something that is an admission that you haven't studied them well enough. The other side of the argument says that score marking can help illuminate some of the things that you have revealed through the score study process. It can help make rehearsals more efficient, more productive, and get your head out of the score so you can make concerts more engaging with the ensemble. My personal philosophy is somewhere in between. It's a hybrid. I tend to mark scores when it's necessary to do so, when I have a lot of music to learn, or I need to learn a piece quickly, or towards the end of the process when there are things that I guess I just can't memorize or I just can't get internalized, and I say, well, I've studied this piece a lot, and for some reason that feature is not sticking with me, so I'm going to go ahead and mark it. Whatever system you use, make sure it does two things. First, that it has to make the score look clearer and less confusing. If you have markings that clutter and are more confusing, it defeats the purpose. And the second thing is that it gets your head out of the score more, and it doesn't encourage you to look down more. It's very easy to write the kind of markings in there that say, oh, let me look at that, let me look at that, and that is counterproductive to what we're trying to do through score marking. Some people like to use colors. They might assign one color to mean meter, another color to mean dynamics, another color to mean phrases, measure numbers. So every color has something different, and then they associate whenever they see that color, they know the information it's giving them. Or if they need a certain type of information, they know to quickly get that color out of what they see in front of them. Other folks say that's just too cluttered and it encourages too much score marking and just prefer a pencil or just simple black. All this depends on what works for you. Again, if it fits the two criteria, that it makes things less confusing and less cluttered overall and makes the score clearer and gets your head out of the score more often. For me, the most important aspect to mark is meter. And I'll admit, I often mark the meters regularly because, to me, that's the one thing I can't mess up. I might miss a cue, I might have a tempo that's slightly off, but if I miss a meter, then I can create a train wreck. And so for me, I'll often either use pencil for that or sometimes even red if there's a lot of different meters shifting back and forth. And it's just a big, in the middle of the score for me, a big number. So if it's 3-4, I just write a big 3. If it's a 4-4, I write a big 4. And then I do it as it shifts. I try to just do one of them so I just see it right in the middle so I can glance down as I need to. Because that's the main thing. I don't want to have to worry about, wait, is this measure in 4-4? I want to know it well enough, but I want to have the freedom to just glance down and go, boom, that's in 4-4. And I see a 2-4 coming up. There it is. That's all I need because I see a big 2 in front of me and I can just grab it and go. Some people like to put the numbers of the meters in on the very top margin. Some people like to put one on the top half, one on the bottom half. It's whatever works for you that makes it less cluttered and more likely that you're going to get your head out of the score. For mixed meter, there are a number of variations that we can use. I prefer, meaning if we're in 5, if there's a 5-8, so if a quarter note is getting the pulse and all of a sudden we get a 5-8 measure. For me, I use a combination of triangles and either vertical lines or L's. The triangles are the 3s, the vertical lines or the L's are the 2s. So a 5-8 as a 1-2-3-4-5, 1-2-3-4-5, or 1-2-3-1-2, a 3 and 2 subdivision would be for me a triangle and then an L, or triangle and a slash. A 2-3, a 1-2-1-2-3, 1-2-1-2-3 would be a slash and then a triangle. Some people just like to put numbers. They like to put 3-2 or 2-3. For me, I don't want those numbers because I associate the numbers with the big pulse, that pulse, not the subdivision pulse. So I don't want to get inadvertently confused because I see numbers out there, and there's a lot of numbers on the page anyway in a lot of cases, that the less numbers I can put in there, the better off for me. Whatever works for you. If there's a 7-8 of some sort, and it's going to be a 2-2-3, so I would often write slash, slash, triangle. But if there's a lot of mixed meter within that, 2-4s, 4-4s, 7-8s, I might put a big 3 on top and underneath the slash, slash, 3. So if I'm glancing down quickly, I can see, oh, there's a 3 pattern coming, and that 3 pattern is divided as a 2-2-3. So it's just big picture stuff because I don't want to miss, if I have something I don't want to miss, it's the meter. If we have, let's go back to the big pulse, say a 5-4 measure. I'll often put slashes in there, and you'll often see this in score. So just slashes to show how that 5-4 is going to be grouped. Is it going to be 2 and then 3? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 3, 2. So one big slash, two small slashes, and then another big slash and two small slashes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I know how to divide that pattern. That system works for a lot of people. Ultimately, you have to do whatever works for you. Beyond that, to me, the second most important thing to put in the score is phrasing. And this is often done at the top of the score, so the top margin. And a good way to do it is coming out of the measure to put some sort of bracket. I like a vertical line, or a slanted line this way that kind of creates a bracket. And then I write in a number in pencil. I don't want it to be too bold because I don't want to think it's a meter. A small number in pencil that tells me how many measures the phrase that begins there is. So if it's a 4-measure phrase, and we often see lots of 4-measure phrases, I just put that little bracket and then a 4. Sometimes I get in a groove where I don't even write the 4 because I just know there's so many 4-measure phrases. If I just see a bracket, unless otherwise noted, it's a 4-measure phrase. If it's a 3-measure phrase, I'll write a 3. If it's a 5, a 5. And then you have to decide, okay, 6s, 7s, where is the point where you want to break it into smaller units? I don't want to put a 13 there because I probably want to think of that in smaller chunks, even if I also know it's part of a larger phrase. I probably don't want too many 2s or 1s in there because I want to associate those in larger chunks. It doesn't mean you can't use either one. So if you want to use a 12 in there, you might say, okay, this is going to be a 5-5-2. So you write the 12 and in parentheses 5 plus 5 plus 2, so you know this 12-measure phrase is a 5-measure phrase, a 5-measure phrase, and then a 2-measure extension. Sometimes there's something that feels like a 4-measure phrase, and then there's a 1-measure tacked at the end, so you can either interpret that as a 5-measure phrase or a 4-measure phrase with a 1 tacked on. So I sometimes put two vertical lines this way to show as a 4-measure phrase, and then there's this 1-measure phrase that's not really related to anything. It just feels as a transition, and then it goes to the next phrase. Find something that works for you with the brackets and numbers above the score. It's really useful for a lot of reasons. First, it helps communication in rehearsals, that you can just say, oh yeah, let's start at this measure because I know that's a logical spot in the music. It makes you make decisions about how the music should go. It's not just, yep, 324 measures. Nope, I have no idea how they relate to each other. You can say, yep, there's an 8-measure phrase, then there's a 9-measure phrase, and the composer does something very interesting by having a bunch of 3-measure phrases. And then, so it really ties into our score study. And finally, for conducting purposes, it helps get our head out of the score, because instead of seeing everything in 1-measure chunks, we can look down and get a big chunk of 6, and then not have to look down to the score until that 6 is up. It's like taking a big breath of air, and you can use, instead of lots of little breaths, take one big breath. Or another analogy might be reading. You don't want to read the word house, h-a-u-s-uh. It's just too many small chunks to go, but if you just see a big chunk of house, or even better, the house, or the house is orange, that's going to be much more efficient, and the same way with phrasing. So it can really help our understanding of the piece and our memorization of it. I often also write, and this is often in black or in pencil, important fermatas or caesuras or phrase or breaks in sound. This is similar to the meter, where this is stuff I don't want to mess up. If there is supposed to be a big grand pause at the end of measure 22, I need to make sure I don't miss that, so I'll often mark that. If there's a fermata, I might highlight the fermata or write it in myself to know, yep, there it is, and I'll often write the number on top of the fermata on which beat the fermata is. So you'll see the fermata symbol, and then you'll see a 3 above it. So I can quickly glance down and say, oh yep, in that measure there's a fermata on beat 3. I don't have to worry about it, I don't have to search for it. Yes, the more I work on the piece, the less I need that sort of marking. And you might eventually transition away from these things. But if score study is something that you think can help you, that's a pretty good strategy for writing that sort of thing. Be careful that there can be a lot of numbers involved here. Numbers for phrases, numbers for meters, numbers for what beat things are going to release on, what where the fermatas are, where the grand pauses are. So you have to be careful to make sure things don't get too cluttered. Avoid putting every single little bit of information in there because it's going to get confusing. And it's going to force you to go like this to figure out what the heck is going on. So try to use only the stuff that you do need. People often like to put cues and mark those. Again, try to only put the cues that you know, boy, I keep forgetting that timpani cue on the end of three. Or the trombones requested that I cue them because they were having trouble counting, that sort of thing. If you put every single cue in, then you've really put no cues in there. And a good way to indicate cues is just to use a bracket. Some people like a half moon in front of the voice that's playing, or they like a square bracket. I would encourage you to do it slightly before the voice enters, because we have to cue it slightly before they enter. We can't cue it at the same time, or we can't start our cueing process at the same time. And then write a small abbreviation. So trumpet might be TPT. Right next to the bracket, to the left of it. Violins might be V or VLN. Some people just use a Roman numeral 1, meaning for first violins, 2 is second violins. Some people even like to use pluses and zeros and tic-tac-toe signs and sorts of things for different brass instruments, so you don't have to write horn or HN. They can write a plus or a zero, whatever resonates with them. A triangle in the percussion might literally be a triangle. You can come up with symbols and abbreviations for those. For me, I rarely put dynamics in. Sometimes I do if it's something that's very important, but I like to think that the score study has taken me to the point where I know that. I will often put groups of instruments or counter melodies that I know need to be rehearsed together. So if you have something that is somewhat contrapuntal and you know that there are 7 voices that play the melody and they're scattered throughout, it's not just upper woodwinds or not just low brass, it's sometimes useful to say, okay, the melody, and I write the list of the instruments that play that melody. So in rehearsal, well, first it means that I've gone and done my score study and dug out who does what orchestrationally, how the piece is voiced. But it makes it easier in rehearsal for me to say, all right, let's just rehearse the melody. That includes flute, violin, soprano, tenor, and xylophone, and I can just hit it right off the bat that way. Another technique, as we've talked about, is just to literally say everyone who has the melody and put the onus on the ensemble to know who has the melody, and that's a terrific teaching tool, but it's still good to catalog what's going on. You might have another list on that page that says counter melody. So here are the people who have the counter melody. Tenor saxophone, cello, and basses, and timpani. Let's try you guys. You have the melody. And so it's useful that way. On the bottom, if the top is phrasing information and the middle is the meter, the bottom I reserve mostly for harmonic information. And so this is where my score study evidence is usually living. So that's where I would put harmony, usually done in the jazz notation format that we talked about in another video. So that's down at the bottom. So the bottom, harmonic information. In the middle, there is a meter, and at the top, there's phrasing. A few other exceptions to this, sometimes within the body of the piece itself, I might put a circle around an important harmonic note that's in the trombones, or I might circle a chord progression within the violin, so I can see that visually, oh yeah, that's important, and not just have it below. Sometimes at the top margin where the brackets, where the phrasing brackets are, above that sometimes I'll put cues, and that's another way to do cues. Instead of putting a bracket in the middle where you, okay, that's high, that's low, that's in the top of the score, that's the bottom of the score, you might put really important ones all at the top. So you don't use it all the time, but you know if there's something really important, boom, the triangle cue is at the top, and you just wrote in triangle and you can get it that way. You might experiment which way works for you. Really, all of this takes experimentation. Just make sure it follows those two rules. It makes the score easier to understand, and it gets your head out of the score more often, and find your personal way to do score study.